Rev up your engines! Now, they say you can't fix stupid. Now, with people, hey, that's probably true. But with cars, it's definitely not true. Because I've spent the last 52 years fixing stupid designs that the manufacturers come with, and I'm gonna talk about some of the dumbest ones today. Now, one of the stupidest things I have to fix all the time these days are fuel pumps. They used to have fuel pumps that had two bolts holding them onto the engine. They'd pump as the engine spins, put gas in the carburetor in. Simple design. You could change them out in 5 minutes. But of course, then they went to electric fuel pumps. But still, they'd be on the bottom of the car because that's the lowest point where the gas is. And you just have to jack it up, take it off. Wasn't that big of a deal. But today, the engineers have decided that they put them inside a gas tank. So the only thing they ever do is push. They don't suck it up. It's more efficient. But it makes changing a fuel pump a gigantic pain in the rear end. Even my 94 Celica has a fuel pump in the gas tank, but being a Toyota, it's still got the original pump. Those Nipidenso pumps work pretty good. If you take out the back seat, there's an access panel. So you can just take the screws out. It's still a smelly mess, but you take the screws out and take the cover off and the pump is inside. It's a smelly mess, yes, but at least you don't have to drop the gas tank. Because on many American cars, they made it so you had to drop the whole gas tank in order to change it. When the pump did go out, you'd be full of gas. You know, this heavy gas tank that you'd have to empty the gas out, take it down, then replace the pump. It could cost over $1,000 in some cases for something that used to take 5 minutes to do. Now, the next stupid thing are water pumps that have stupid plastic impeller blades inside. Ages ago, some moron, the first one I saw was in an Audi, decided that they still had metal water pumps that ran off a fan belt. The impeller blade inside, instead of being made out of metal, they made it out of plastic, and it was pressed onto the shaft that spun. Of course, it's cheaper to make that way. And maybe they had the idea plastic doesn't rust. But really, as long as you keep clean cooling in, the blades on most water pumps, they're not gonna rust either, you know? It's not like they rust like they're in salt water. They're in coolant that's got anti-corrosive additives, so it's not that big of a deal. You don't see them rusting out. When I was a young mechanic, yeah, guys were cheap and they'd run a car in pure water, and then of course they'd rust. But modern cars, you don't have to think about that anyway. As any plastic thing inside the hot cooling system, they'll slip right off of the shaft. Then you see the shaft is spinning, so you think the water pump's okay, but inside the blades don't spin, they don't pump any water. Now that took me for a loop the first time I fixed one, because you pressure test it, there's no leaks. You look at the water pump and the belt's spinning, it's spinning fine, it's not wobbling, but the blade on the inside fell off. And not being Superman with x-ray vision, I can't see inside the engine. The only way to do that is to take it all apart, and on the Audi it was a pain in the butt because it ran off of the timing belt, so you had to take the timing belt off. It was a very involved job. And there's a lot of modern cars out there that have plastic impellers that do have problems. Now, whenever I fix one, I make a point of getting a water pump that's got a solid metal impeller on it for the blades to pump the water. I'm not gonna replace it with another plastic piece of crap. I try to replace stupidness with intelligence. Plastic with metal. And another stupid I have to fix all the time are stupid plastic headlamps that fade away. Sometimes so bad you can't see at night because it blocks the light. Now look at my old 94 Celica. Glass headlamps. They're shiny as the day they were made. They're glass. They get dirty, you clean them. That's the only thing you gotta worry about. Now, of course, I got videos to show you how you can polish them if you wanna polish the plastic ones when they wear out. You're gonna have to keep polishing them year after year after year because they will keep fading away. Or you can just replace them with aftermarket ones like I did on this Matrix here. But really, replace something that's fade-free forever glass with cheap plastic? That's just plain stupid. Now, the next stupid thing I have to fix all the time are stupid plastic painted bumpers. They're called bumpers for a reason. So you can bump into things without doing any damage. I remember when I was a kid years ago driving around with my friend in his Ford Fairlane, had those big old chrome bumpers. Somebody bashed into the back of us at a stoplight, and he gets out and he looks and he says, no damage done, and he drives away. These days, it would have cost a fortune to repaint and repair all the broken plastic pieces. And yes, people are slobs. I've had these repainted twice in the front and twice in the back because people run into them in parking lots, hit them, go away. Then you get ugly black stuff sticking out. On my old 81 SR5, that had black plastic bumpers. I had a girl rear-end me while she was putting makeup on while she was driving down the road. A lot of it was rubberized more too, so it could flex. It flexed in, came out, couldn't even tell it was hit. I just looked at her and said, "Bah, you ran into me, I'm not getting involved in this crap," and away I went. If that same collision, which was about 20 miles an hour, happened with my wife's Lexus, I would have got the insurance companies involved and the police, because on that car, easily it could have been $2,000-$3,000 of damage. All because they decided to use painted plastic bumpers. Now the next stupid thing I have to fix all the time are, stupid plastic radiators. Now when I was a young mechanic, we didn't have to replace radiators that often because they cracked and broke. They were soldered together, really solid units. But decades ago, Mercedes was one of the first companies, strangely enough, a luxury car maker, to put plastic radiators in it. They are so much cheaper to make. The aluminum cores are cheaper, and then they have plastic tanks. Well, the plastic tanks, you can't solder, they're just crimped in. So the machine that makes them crimps them fast. The much simpler process, much lower cost to build. But guess what? Heat degrades plastic, eventually gets brittle and it cracks. You could heat a brass and copper radiator a million times up and down, it's not gonna make the thing crack. But plastic, maybe not such a smart idea. And if you go further into numbskull engineering, like BMW, not only are the radiators plastic, a lot of the connection hoses are plastic, the intake manifold's plastic. All this plastic crap has hot coolant going through it. Of course it's going to destroy the plastic over time. And it doesn't matter how clean you keep your coolant. Yes, dirty coolant is going to eat up metal. So if you have a metal radiator, if you have dirty coolant, it can make it rust and eat it up. Dirty coolant, clean coolant, doesn't matter with plastic. It's the heat that destroys the plastic. And of course, one of the hottest things in your car is the cooling system. It's taking the heat from the engine and then dissipating it to the atmosphere through the radiator. Now, if customers of mine that want to keep their vehicles forever, if that plastic crap or radiator goes out, I try to find a metal replacement one. With collector's cars like Mustangs, Corvettes, it's pretty easy because there's a big aftermarket for them. But with plain Jane cars like Corollas and Impalas, you're pretty much stuck with replacing it with another plastic radiator. There aren't anybody really making mass volumes of metal ones anymore because it's so much cheaper to make the plastic ones and then just mark them up and sell them. Now the next stupid thing that I'm always fixing on cars is stupid plastic painted door handles. Heat gets to them. The ultraviolet rays of the sun get to them. Then you pull them, they crack and break. Bad enough that you gotta replace the stupid plastic piece of crap, but then you also have it painted to match the car. Or it looks stupid because, let's say, the dealer has one, then they got to paint it. Just it costs you a couple $100 or more for one. You can go aftermarket on the internet, sure. And you can get a black plastic one for probably $15. And they'll work perfectly fine. But it's not painted to match the car. So then you got to go get it painted. And if you got an old car like this, odds are the paint will never match. You can't perfectly match it. Our human eyes can see the difference, so it won't match. I prefer the chrome-plated ones. They look nice, and if your car doesn't have them, you can often buy replacement chrome-plated ones. Or on an economy car like this Matrix, they come with black plastic. So when they do break, you can just go online and buy a cheap one. This is a replacement one. There's one on the other side. It's a replacement one, too. They look perfectly fine. You don't have to deal with paint. And the last stupid design I hate are these uni fan belts, where there's one fan belt that drives everything on the engine. So if anything goes wrong, like power steering pump, the belt flies off, you can't drive the car. The water pump won't work. The alternator won't work. That's just designing things so they're cheaper to make. Heck, when they started to make them this way, say I get a customer with a car that's a few years old, the air conditioning compressor breaks and the belt flies off. And then they say, well, I can't afford all that money to fix the air conditioner. Can you make it work without? And when they were simpler systems, we would just bypass the air conditioning compressor, put a different size belt on. But you can't do that with these new modern one system. One belt might run 8 different things. And hey, there's no way you're gonna be able to find a belt that if you take the air conditioner off, is gonna be able to be routed correctly and work. They're basically telling you, you gotta fix everything in a car if something breaks or you can't drive it. Check your fan belt every once in a while. You start hearing noises coming from it. Fix it sooner than later. or you could be stranded in the middle of nowhere. So now you know the truth. Although you can't really fix stupid in people, you can try to fix stupid in car designs. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.